Welcome to this e-learning module presented by Department of Kumar Vidya, All India Institute of Ayurveda, New Delhi. Today we are going to discuss about scorpion envenomation in children. So scorpion sting is a very dramatic life-threatening medical emergency which is usually encountered in villages of tropical and subtropical countries. Now, mortality due to scorpion sting was as high as 30% in the pre-Pliocene era. However, now the mortality has significantly reduced to about 1% due to the use of Pliocene and advanced healthcare facilities available to the patients. Now, out of 89 species of scorpion found in India, only 2 are of medical importance. They are Mesobuthus stamulus, that is Indian red scorpion, and Palamnius gravimenus, or better known as Indian black scorpion. So these 2 species are of medical importance. So as you can see, these are the figures of the first one is the Mesobuthus stamulus, is the red scorpion. It is smaller in size and it is most lethal of all scorpion species. And this one is the black Indian black scorpion, Palamnius species. These are larger scorpions and can grow up to 7 inches, and these are mainly found in outdoors. So regarding the habitat of these scorpions usually prefer warm and dry regions. They are commonly found in underground burrows, services in the dwellings, under debris and logs of wood, banana, sugar cane, and usually in coconut plantations. So these scorpions are nocturnal predators and they only sting when disturbed in their hideouts. And it has to be remembered that a scorpion sting does not always mean envenomation, because the scorpion can control its ejaculation of venom. So regarding the scorpion venom, the components of the scorpion venom are very complex and these are species specific. The main toxins which are present in this scorpion venom are phospholipase, acetylcholinesterase, hyaluronidase, serotonin, and various neurotoxins. Particularly, the venom of Buthus species of India contains abundant phospholipase A, which is responsible for gastrointestinal and pulmonary hemorrhages as well as disseminated intravascular coagulation. Now, regarding the pathophysiology of scorpion sting or scorpion envenomation, the scorpion venom has a variety of effects, like it opens the sodium channels present at the presynaptic nerve terminals, and also it inhibits the calcium dependent potassium channels. These two mechanisms, that is opening of the sodium channels and inhibiting the calcium dependent potassium channels, are responsible for a phenomenon which is marked in scorpion venom known as autonomic storm. Apart from this autonomic storm, there is stimulation of alpha receptors which causes cool extremities, tachycardia, and hypertension. The raised angiotensin 1 levels, which gets converted to angiotensin 2, leads to increased sympathetic outflow. Apart from all these mechanisms, metabolic effects are also mediated by the alpha receptor stimulation, which are manifest as suppression of insulin secretion, hyperglycemia, hyperkalemia, free fatty acid accumulation, and elevation of free radicals, which are responsible for myocardial damage. The scorpion's venom has a direct toxic effect on neurons, so child may present with seizures and encephalopathy. It can also cause disseminated intravascular coagulation. The toxin of the Indian red scorpion has very little or no effect on skin, but the black scorpion causes severe skin manifestations. Other manifestations which are not commonly seen in India are pancreatitis, hepatic necrosis, and intravascular hemolysis leading to acute renal failure. And most important pathophysiology form of the scorpion venom is autonomic storm. This autonomic storm has two parts, cholinergic storm and adrenergic storm. The cholinergic storm is the initial and short-lived, while the adrenergic storm is subsequent and more prolonged. Now let us proceed to the clinical features of scorpion envenomation. In general, symptoms of the scorpion sting starts within seconds to minutes and progress to reach maximum severity in 5 hours. These symptoms usually subside within 1 or 2 days. The clinical features can be categorized into two forms. Number one is local manifestations and number two is systemic manifestations. Now let us discuss what are the local manifestations which are seen in scorpion sting. So the most important local manifestation is local pain. So this clinical feature has an inverse relationship with progression, with further progression of the symptomatology. That means in those patients who have severe local pain, initially there is no further systemic manifestations like autonomic storm, pulmonary edema, etc. While in those patients who have various systemic manifestation, it is experienced that there was little or no local pain in the beginning. So the local pain in such patients may reappear during recovery from systemic complications. Now this local pain is due to the serotonin which is present in the scorpion venom. Severe burning pain is experienced at the site of sting immediately, and this pain radiates to the corresponding dermatome. Sometimes local edema, sweating, pinhead bleeding, local fasciculation and spasms in the surrounding muscles is also seen. So presence of local pain in the beginning and appearance of local pain after treatment, which was absent in the beginning, both are good prognostic indicators. The former indicates non-poisonous sting and latter indicates recovery from envenomation. Now I will discuss about the systemic manifestations. The systemic manifestations usually occur due to the autonomic storm or autonomic stimulations, and it's characterized by mydriasis, profuse sweating, urticaria, excessive salivation, vomiting and priapism. So priapism is the prolonged erection of the penis, usually without sexual arousal. So as you see, there is profuse sweating and dilated pupil. This is sweating and mydriasis, and in this child there is excessive salivations due to the scorpion sting, and it is the case of priapism. Apart from this, there will be hypertension, bradyarrhythmias or tachyarrhythmias, ventricular premature contractions, pulmonary edema may develop within 2 to 3 hours leading to death. In some cases, intracerebral hemorrhage resulting in hemiparesis may occur, and seizures or convulsions may also occur. So earlier ECG changes are there. Early changes include peak T waves. Peak T waves in the lead V2 to V6. So you can see this peaked T wave in V2 to V6. You can also observe Q waves, ST segment elevation in lead 1 and AVL, and left anterior hemi block. The patient may suffer from hyperglycemia, acute pancreatitis and allergic reactions including anaphylaxis. The Indian black scorpion or the Palamnius species causes local pain, paresthesias, mild autonomic nervous system excitations, pulmonary infiltration, eosinophilia, salivation, nausea, sweating and mild hypotension. Now, interestingly, children under 10 years of age are more likely to develop toxicity than older victims. Effects are more severe in infants and toddlers. Now, for the investigation's point of view, you may need X-ray chest for evidence of pulmonary edema, and in echocardiography you can find left ventricular dilatation and left ventricular systolic dysfunctions, and ECG, as we discussed, that there may be tented T waves, macular infection pattern, prolonged QT, then left anterior hemiblock and low voltage. Apart from this, you may need some biochemical investigations for diagnosing hyperglycemia and hyperkalemia. So regarding the management of scorpion sting, so there are various aspects of the management. So before going to the management part, it has to be remembered that most victims were present without hypertension or any cardiac disease, and children over the age of 5 years can usually well handled at home. For pain relief, local application of ice and other supportive measures should be provided, and this can be handled at home. However, patients with cardiac problems, hypertension, elderly victims and children under the age of 5 should be referred immediately to a hospital for evaluation. So during transport to the hospital, the affected extremities should be immobilized. There is no need to apply any tourniquet. Local application of ice is beneficial in relieving pain. However, prolonged cryotherapy is contraindicated. A negative pressure suction device may be used, but do not incise prior to suction. On arrival at the hospital, admit all patients with systemic manifestations to intensive care unit under close electrocardiographic, echocardiographic, and if necessary, invasive hemodynamic monitoring. Patients with respiratory failure or with CNS disturbances may need mechanical ventilation and oxygen administration to all serious cases. So regarding the various aspects of management, number one aspect is the local pain relief. The patients with systemic manifestations usually have mild tolerable pain and they need no treatment. But when pain is very severe, various modalities like NSAIDs, local lignocaine and dihydroemetine may be used. So second modality of the management is the fluid therapy. As you know that in early cholinergic term, the patient may have vomiting and profuse sweating. So this causes fluid loss and can lead to hypotension. So depending upon the clinical condition of the child, either oral or parenteral fluids are to be administered. In children with left ventricular dysfunction and pulmonary edema, fluid administration should be cautiously provided and preferably with CVP monitoring. Now the next modality is the vasodilators administration. So in the scorpion envenomation, this is the mainstay of the treatment. So various drugs, various vasodilators are available like prazosin, sodium nitroprusside, nitroglycerin, isosorbate, dinitrate. So these are the various vasodilators which can be used. So dobutamine used as an inotrope also has a vasodilator property. So the most important out of these vasodilators is the prazosin. We will discuss prazosin in detail. So prazosin is the first line of management in the scorpion envenomation. So this is a postsynaptic competitive alpha 1 adrenergic receptor antagonist. It is a cellular, physiological, pharmacological and metabolic antidote of the scorpion venom. So it is not indicated as a prophylaxis for all the patients with scorpion sting, but should be given at the earliest to all with any evidence of autonomic storm and the features like vomiting, sweating, cold extremities, etc. It is available as 1 mg cold tablet. In any form, sustained release form of prazosin should not be used. Prazosin can be administered orally or through nasogastric tube. The first dose phenomenon leading to hypotension associated with this prazosin can be prevented by plenty of oral fluids and not allowing the child to sit or stand and monitoring the child's blood pressure every 30 minutes for first 3 to 5 hours. Prazosin should be given irrespective of blood pressure in presence of good hydration. The dose of prazosin is 30 microgram per kg per dose, repeated 3 to 4 hourly to maximum of 4 doses. So after the era of prazosin, this prazosin has reduced the mortality of the scorpion envenomation from 30% to less than 1%. It is very cheap, fast acting and free from anaphylaxis, highly effective and easily available. Now the second most important vasodilator is the sodium nitroprusside. So this is the treatment of choice in case of pulmonary edema where time is essence. It is given by continuous infusion because its effect is quite transient. So only freshly prepared solution that is less than 4 hours old is to be used. Bottle should be wrapped with an opaque paper or cloth and no other drug should be added to the infusion. It is given in a dose of 0.3 to 0.5 microgram per kg per minute. Oral prazosin should be added 1 hour before the stopping of sodium nitroprusside drip. If sodium nitroprusside is not available, nitroglycerin infusion or isosorbide dinitrates sublingually can also be used. Dobutamine can be used in combination with SNP drip or sodium nitroprusside drip for the treatment of massive pulmonary edema. In some cases, diazepam is given to reduce the anxiety of the child and it may also reduce the seizure activity. It also antagonizes the scorpion venom's action on chloride ion channel. So it has to be remembered that atropine, there is no role of atropine, corticosteroids, morphine, lytic cocktail, nifedipine or captopril. So atropine, it is given for symptomatic relief from clinical effects of cholinergic storm. But unfortunately, it increases the morbidity and mortality and should not be administered in a scorpion envenomation patient. The corticosteroids usually potentiate the toxic effects of excessive catecholamine on myocardium. So it should be avoided. The morphine worsens the cardiac arrhythmias and the lytic cocktail potentiates the effects of scorpion venom and may interfere with respiratory reflexes and prolongs hypotension and increase the morbidity and mortality. Similarly, nifedipine causes reflex tachycardia and has a negative inotropic effect and should be avoided. And captopril aggravates hyperkalemia. So all these therapies should not be used in the palliative intensive care of scorpion envenomation. So antivenom therapy, in some countries a good based serum derivative antivenom is available, but its efficacy is not very high and there is controversial issues with this use of antivenom. And most patients develop serum sickness syndrome within 2 weeks of this antivenom administration. In India, a recently scorpion antivenom has been developed against the Mesobuthus tamulus species. The recommended dose is 1 vial and reconstituted in 10 ml of injection water initially and followed by further doses if required. But usually this antivenom therapy is useless in scorpion sting or scorpion envenomation. So let us come to the prevention of the scorpion sting, how it can be prevented. So there are various points which can be adopted for preventing the scorpion sting. Number one is the clear debris and rubbish from all the areas of work or rest. Some repellents may be used in areas of scorpion infestations, like spraying a mixture of 2% chlorine, 10% DDT and 0.2% pyrethroid in an oil base is very effective. Alternatively, A mixture of fuel oil, kerosene, and small amount of cryocrete can also be used. So shoes, clothing, and beddings should be inspected for presence of scorpions. Do not reach into dark corners, receptacles, or boxes. Always use a flashlight first to check for scorpions. And remember, as a rule, if one scorpion has been encountered in a particular area, there will be others around. Female generally give birth to about 50 to 60 young, which remain close to where they were born. It is important to locate and kill them all. Otherwise, there is chances of scorpion envenomation. So let us come to the summarize the whole topic. The scorpion sting. If there is severe local pain at the site of sting, it is unlikely to progress to systemic manifestations. Autonomic storm is the basic pathogenetic mechanism leading to all clinical features and complications. And pulmonary edema is one of the most important manifestations. Warming up of extremities and appearance of local pain are suggestive of recovery. Scorpion antivenom is useless. Oral prazosin is the antidote of scorpion venom and should be used at the earliest. Massive pulmonary edema needs sodium nitroprusside drip. Atropine, corticosteroids, morphine, lytic cocktail, nifedipine, and captopril should not be used in scorpion envenomation. Thank you for learning. Do like, subscribe, and share. Thank you very much.